Good morning. Despite the measures in Finance Minister Michael Wilson's conservative budget, the dollar has dropped a little bit again this morning and is hovering around the 70-cent mark. That may or may not upset all the plans to bring interest rates down to 9.6% so that the federal government can achieve its budgetary deficit below the magic figure of $30 million. That's on the heavy side of the budget. But you'll notice that cabinet ministers, including our Pat Carney, took a $10,000 pay cut, which may be largely symbolic, and that all MPs are taking a $1,000 pay cut. But the question that I must still put first to Pat Carney, the Minister of Energy in the Conservative government, is, and don't answer it yet, please, Pat, when are the gas prices going to go down some more? Ms. Carney is here this morning to have a bash at the budget with old Webster. And then, I almost said on the lighter side, but if I do, I shall be blacklisted from coast to coast. I'm going to speak to a person from Media Watch. And the kind of thing that Media Watch doesn't like is this particular segment of a Tourism Canada ad which shows nurses kicking up their knees. There we go. There are the nurses kicking up their knees in a very sexy and somewhat disgusting fashion. And due to the pressure from Media Watch, Tourism Canada has cleaned up that commercial. And I'll want later this morning your reaction on this sexism and stereotyping. And the spokesman from Media Watch is Samantha Sanderson, a lawyer in family law. But first, seriously, to the budget, gas prices, job creation, if much, and Pat Carney, the Minister of Energy, after the break. My first question to Pat Carney, the oil man of the year. Do you object to that oil man of the year as a sexist remark?
Well, I think it sounds better than oil person of the year, and there's so few women in the oil patch that oil woman of the year doesn't really apply. So in this case, I take it as quite interesting that the Calgary Petroleum people would actually even consider a woman for the position of oil man of the year.
But they won't let you into their club.
No, they won't let me into their club.
Males only?
Certainly not women only.
Will you, would you advocate that your colleagues change the law to stop these sexist discriminating clubs?
Yes, I tell you why. It's because they work against women in business. There are women in Calgary in the banking business, in the oil business, in the service business, who don't get access to the business lunch climate where people do deals and make negotiations, and it's hard for them to advance. So I think any kind of discrimination is bad, and discrimination in the business community hurts the advancement of women in business.
Well enough, but that's a fairly light topic. When my first question was to be, we've only seen the price of gas go down 2 cents a litre, with the price of oil now, you know, crashing to about $13 a barrel. Why is it not going down more?
There's about a 60-day period while the oil moves through the system. For instance, one company this week told me that they still have 20 million barrels of higher-priced oil still moving in the system. So we should see further drops this month in March, and I think there's even a possibility that crude oil prices could ease down again. It's a very volatile situation. And the consumers have started to get some of the benefit of the drop. They'll get further benefits this month and in April, but I can't tell you how much.
But you're disappointed that it's only gone down 2 cents a litre so far.
No, I'm not disappointed, because most of the drop in oil prices came in January. So if you if you consider that 60 days is an average, I mean, it can be up to 120 days in some cases. Because of the geography of the country. I'm just relieved to know that they're starting down, and I know that there'll be further decreases coming up for consumers.
Mind you probably had to hit Petro-Canada on the head to start the whole ball of wax rolling.
Absolute libel, so be careful what you say about that, Jack. I didn't do
all
that.
All I said was you probably had to hit them
no,
on the head.
I never did at all. I did not discuss it with Bill Hopper or Petro-Canada, and I did not get advance warning. I was just very pleased to see that Petro-Canada and Imperial and Shell and everybody else started dropping their prices.
Now, what about the budget? The big disappointment in the budget, to be deadly serious, is that there seemed to be nothing in it for the West. We see Wilson boasting about 585,000 new jobs and an unemployment rate of less than 10%. It sure as devil doesn't reflect in British Columbia, does it?
British Columbia still, although it's still pulling out of recession, British Columbia has enjoyed 51,000 more jobs since we took over in office. That's about twice the rate of job creation that the Liberals created in the previous 55 months. So that's a pretty good record. And also our unemployment rate has dropped nearly 3 percentage points. I think it's, I have the figures here somewhere. It's unemployment is still too high in BC, but it's dropped from 15.2% to 12.9% since we took office.
That's
going down, that's what we are looking at.
Just 2 points there, though. You would concede, would you not, Pat Carney, that the 51,000 new jobs, whatever they are or whatever they are, do not in any way replace the 30 to 40,000 high-paid jobs we lost in logging and mining, right?
Yes, but we lost those jobs in logging and mining for a number of factors which had to do with decline in the markets for forest products and modernization. I mean, when we modernize the industry here, there is a job loss. Even in spite of all those problems, 51,000 more British Columbians are working today since the Mulroney government was elected.
What is it in the actual budget for job creation? All I can see is a figure about $800 million to be spent over the years ahead. You've actually cut back on some of the retraining programs.
No, that's an additional money. I think the total training program is about $2 billion. And the, you know, we're doing this in stages, Jack. We brought in special programs for youth before. Now we are bringing in special programs for the older worker. I mean, I sit in my office and hear from older workers who are displaced, who have trouble finding jobs, and we're also bringing in new job programs for people on welfare. So we're moving steadily to extend those job programs to those groups in society which are having trouble finding jobs. So it's a pretty big effort and it's very successful. 580,000 jobs since September 1984 is a big number. And the job creation in January in this country was a record level. 129,000 jobs were created in January.
But is it also not a fact that since the collapse of the oil prices, for which you can't particularly be blamed, I don't suppose, that all the exploration that was going on in the oil patch has suddenly ceased?
No, that's not true, Jack. The oil prices have dropped. Drilling last year after our Western Accord was at record levels. Employment increased dramatically. There will be some decline in exploration later this year, the companies tell me, because of the drop in oil prices. But there's still a steady base of exploration and development going on. I mean, we took the PGRT tax off all new production.
Right.
So anytime you go out and drill a new well, you're not paying that tax. That's an impetus. And PGRT, the tax is being phased out as of the 1st of February over the next 3 years. That gives them a little comfort zone. So yes, some exploration development will be cut back from a very high level, but there's going to be a lot of good, solid base exploration continue.
Now, what about the tax basis? Business are not quite so happy this morning as they were yesterday with some of the corporate tax additions, and it's going to increase the cost of doing business. And of course, on the income tax side, it's the middle class who get hammered, isn't it?
Jack, we have reduced government spending sharply, $6 billion, I think, in the next year. We are paying down that deficit, which is strangling us. We've cut about $10 billion off that deficit in the last two budgets, in the last 2 years, which is historic. I mean, it's the first time any government has ever actually cut spending and cut the deficit. And I just don't think that people really are concerned about paying the extra taxes when they know that the overall thrust of the government is to bring our affairs under control. Remember one thing, if you don't pay it in taxes, if you don't pay the money in taxes, you're paying the money in higher rates of inflation, you're paying it in higher interest rates on your mortgage, and in higher costs of borrowing. I mean, either way, when you have a deficit the size we have, when you're paying, you know, $1 out of every $3 we collect on interest, you know, Canadians are paying. This way they're paying in taxes and enjoying lower mortgage rates and lower rates of inflation.
Even though there is no gore on the floor, everyone's agreed, Tory times are tough times. If you don't bring down the inflation rate, you cannot meet your target for a reduction of a year's deficit below $30 billion. Am I correct in that summation?
Tory times are innovative times. We have done something which nobody seems to really have realized. For years, Canadians were told you can't cut the deficit because you'll create unemployment. If you try and cut the deficit, you will cost people jobs. We have done something so innovative that nobody seems to really understand it. We've cut the deficit and we've created jobs. I mean, that's completely contrary to conventional economic wisdom. We're cutting the deficit, we're cutting expenditures, and we're creating jobs. We're stabilizing inflation, stabilizing interest rates, and showing very good, solid management, and Canadians are enjoying those benefits.
More questions from thee and me to Pat Carney, Minister of Energy, after the break. It's very difficult to follow all these figures in the budget, but I'll agree with you that you've cut spending quite drastically, and we haven't seen the Nielsen papers yet, right?
No, they'll be released on March the 11th. But in my own department, for instance, EMR, I've cut about $2.1 billion in spending in 2 years. That's one of the highest rates. I was with Don Mazankowski in Edmonton yesterday, and he has cut, you know, billions out of transportation. We're making, these are real cuts and real program losses. And this year, I believe it is for the first time, actually, government spending will not increase, you know, program money is going to decrease for the first time in 20 years. I mean, we can't find a period when we're actually spending less rather than more.
And there's going to be 15,000 civil servants phased out largely by attrition over the next 5 years or something.
Well,
they're
being phased out. The 15,000 civil service positions are being phased out. Some of that will be dealt with by attrition, some by early retirement, and some by layoffs. I mean, the people in my department who are going to get pink slips this year are, you know, going to be looking for work.
Well, even if I subscribe to your Tory philosophy and you're going to get the economy in order in due course and fuel the machine of small business to give us jobs, it does mean tough times, does it not? Especially in the West.
No, it's relative. It would be tougher times for everybody. Just think, if we didn't do this, and we were adding to the deficit, which strangles us because it sops up all our revenues to pay the interest on the deficit. I mean, people who charge money on their, you know, charge cards know how those interest costs can escalate and escalate. And if we didn't do this exercise, control government spending, this is the first time that we've ever controlled government spending, that we have not increased government spending, that we're cutting it. Under the years of the Liberals, it went up every year, you know, 10%, 12%, 17%. We're stopping that growth curve. We are controlling government spending. We are cutting government spending. And if we didn't do that, people would pay. They'd pay through higher inflation, higher interest rates, and, you know, and less job creation.
Good point. Local issue. You've still got $69 million on the line for Cominco for the modernization program by buying some of their preferred shares.
Right.
Has the province agreed yet to go in with its $20 million or so?
I understand the province is still working on ways to complete their part of that
Isn't
deal.
Isn't it time they made up their mind so that they can get on with that $278 million modernization of the smelter in Cominco?
I certainly hope that this issue is resolved soon, because it was very tough on trail. And, you know, as an old Kootenay resident, it's tough on trail to be sort of sitting, swinging in the wind, wondering what's happening.
Any prospect of the Vancouver gas pipeline getting any money for British Columbia? You know, what Bennett wants.
Yes, Bennett wants the pipeline. Bennett's original request, Premier Bennett's original request, was too rich. I mean, we just don't have the kind of money for the amount of money that he was asking for. His officials and our officials are working on how we can reduce the cost of the pipeline, and also what will the province contribute in the way of their tax base. Yes, and their tax bases. What can they contribute, and then what can we contribute?
Because we don't really need the gas pipeline, do we, except for the jobs and the kind of mini-mega construction.
Well, I think that Vancouver Island is entitled to natural gas. A lot of the rest of the country has natural gas.
You mean Northern Ontario and Quebec, for instance?
And Vancouver has natural gas, and, you know, the interior of BC has natural gas, and I think that that it's fair for Vancouver Island to have natural gas.
Well, you're regarded as the cabinet minister in the Conservative government with the best image and the best performance record. I wonder what people think about the budget this morning. Go ahead, please.
Good morning, Ms. Carney. Could I ask you a question, please?
Certainly.
Why is it every time a statement comes out of your office that we have to use up this so-called 20 million barrels that we have in storage before the lower prices can come into the pipeline to the consumer? And yet, by the same token, what happens to the 20 million barrels that we have stored of low-price gasoline where the prices go up immediately to the price increase?
Well, they haven't gone up immediately. In the past, Joe Clark was prime minister, if I recall correctly, when prices started going up, there was a 60-day freeze imposed on prices so that consumers would not be immediately charged higher prices. There's, you have to move this product through the pipelines and the refineries and the distribution systems. So there was a 60-day waiting period put on when prices are rising, and effectively we have a period of, around 2 months before they start falling. Remember, the price decreases that you see in the papers these days have started in January, and they are for oil to be delivered several months from now. I mean, January prices are for March delivery. All that oil has to be transported, shipped, refined, processed, and delivered to you. Oil is not something that you just move that quickly.
All right, he doesn't quite believe you, but the prices will come down.
So they have started to come down just about when I said they would.
Go ahead,
reflecting
please.
The pre-Christmas drop. And I'm expecting, some significant drops later in March.
Go ahead, please.
Good morning, Mrs. Carney.
Good morning.
I just would like to agree with Mr. Webster that I agree that I'd like to say that this wage decrease of $1,000 for the MPs is very symbolic. And I'd like to know why, for instance, in the last budget, when you looked at taking money away from the old age pensioners by de-indexing them, why you never look at your own pensions and why we never hear about it being de-indexed.
Well, we are bringing in legislation to de-index the MPs' pensions. We're doing it in stages as the legislation is prepared. We are moving to de-index MPs' pensions. In the meantime, we have taken significant cuts. I mean, the Prime Minister has taken a $20,000 cut in salary over the last 2 years. And I could point out the fact that Mr. John Turner refused to take that cut when we were asked last year to forego $5,000 worth of income. I believe that Mr. Turner was asked to do that, and he did not. But we have taken the cuts last year, and we'll take the cuts this year. In addition, all MPs, including cabinet ministers, lose another $1,000. And if you don't think that's significant, well, you think about other groups in society which would be asked to take a $1,000 pay cut. And I think, it shows that we're prepared to show leadership in this.
You've taken a cut of $9,440.
Right.
Go ahead, please.
Like the first caller, I can't accept the explanation of the minister with regarding the price of gasoline being maintained at its current level. In Blaine, Washington, today you can buy a gallon for $1.13.
American.
3 weeks ago, it was $1.21. They have moved to reduce the price of gasoline for United States citizens. And by the way, in Seattle, it's even cheaper. Now, the tourist business from Washington State, Oregon State, and Idaho has been killed effectively by both the provincial and the federal governments. One fill up in Vancouver and they hightail it back to Seattle. It's psychological, and these governments can't understand what's killing the tourist business in Vancouver.
Is there any answer, though? There is no answer to the imbalance in the gas prices across the border, because you can tell me that the Americans have the benefit of the exchange rate.
Right, and also the Americans do not have a policy yet, although they may move to it, of putting taxes on gasoline. And this country, Canada, at both the federal and the provincial level, have had a policy of putting on gasoline taxes, fuel taxes, to help pay for the social programs. I mean, the Americans don't have Medicare. As I keep, telling Canadians, we buy more than gasoline when we fill up our tank at the pump. We're paying through those taxes for some of the social services that Canadians want and Americans don't have. And if you want to compare prices that way, then you should look to European prices, which have similar social benefits to what we have. And I mean, in the UK, it's around 81 cents a liter. In Denmark, it's 87 cents a liter. If you want to have our kind of social services in Canada, which the Americans don't enjoy, we have to pay for them. And that's the whole thrust of the budget, to pay for the services we get. And comparing gasoline prices should be compared also with medical costs. I mean, the costs that Americans pay for medical insurance is thousands of dollars a year. We don't pay that.
If tourism has to suffer, it has to suffer because of the fact that we've got to pay for our social safety nets and our gas taxes.
We have studies that show that the price of gasoline is not a big deal to tourists.
More after the break. It's a pretty smart idea in the budget to send a $300 checks per child in November each year when you've increased this provision for those who have a taxable income of less than $15,000, wasn't it?
Yes.
It's almost like a campaign gimmick.
Well, no. It's a social measure that responds to our promise to make sure that people who needed the money got the money. And it's going to be important in my constituency of Vancouver Centre because we have a lot of single parents. But just remember, last year we extended the benefits under the child care payments so that, you know, child care payments were increased. But the problem my constituents had is still they had to fill out income tax forms and then they had to wait around for the money and then often they went to tax discounters to get the cash now and then they lost money. So Michael Wilson's brought in this rather innovative scheme that, based on the income tax, people won't have to apply for this, based on their income tax filings, they will get a check in the mail in November of up to $300, I believe,
per child. But
and that about 90% of the people who qualify for that credit, $300 is more or less what they would get. So they get it at a nice time of year too, just before Christmas.
And that's on their 85 tax return if they made an 85 tax return.
If they make an 85 tax return by November, they will get in the mail a green check with their child tax credit in cash.
There is still a hint in there, though. I mean, one of the Tory pieces of your party's philosophy is surely to cut down money going to people who don't need it. And I have a strong suspicion that you'll get after universal access one of these days.
Well, Mr. Wilson in the budget did point out that, you know, we're doing this in stages. We started with the November the 8th statement, which is called Agenda for Change, which said where this party was going in government. Then we brought in the May budget, which implemented part of that and reformed pensions and other social services and started cutting the deficit. This time we're doing more of that, you know, cutting spending, increasing revenues, and further reforming social programs. One of the most innovative parts of this budget is that sales tax rebate to low-income people. We're increasing the sales tax for the
revenues. Which will hit everybody.
Yes, everybody.
The federal sales tax.
But low-income people, I think it's 15,000.
We'll get a
sales tax rebate that's about equivalent to what they have to pay. Again, they get that in cash. So those are the steps that we've taken. Now, beyond that, Mike Wilson has said in the next budget, we will be looking at the social programs, and we will be looking at them with four principles, and I'll read them. First of all, we'll have the Unemployment Insurance Commission report. We've got the McDonald Commission report.
You sure blew that one on the pensions, didn't you?
And he said, do you want to talk about that, or do we want to talk about these principles that we've talked about?
Just finish the principles first.
Okay, Michael says, such measures must respect several basic principles. They must maintain universal access. That's what Canadians want, universal access. They must direct more resources to those most in need. No Canadian argues with that. They must improve the opportunities for individuals to become self-reliant, because Canadians want to become self-reliant. They don't want to be dependent on the social support system. And this really affects you, Jack, because you'll pay for this. The fourth principle is they must reduce the after-tax value of benefits going to higher-income Canadians who do not need assistance. And you can argue that you need as much assistance as, say, my pension mother on Saturna.
Of course not, but the fact remains is that you must do it properly, and you should have done it on the de-indexing of the old-age pensions, but you chickened out.
Well,
and on the other thing, just to get a little hard about it, that move You're now trying to blame everything, wait for the recommendations of the Forger Commission. But that business of denying middle-aged workers unemployment insurance because they'd picked up a measly little pension and a woodworker thing, and then wiping them out was brutal.
Well, I think that's all being addressed in this commission. It's all very easy for you to jack to say, why did you do this and why didn't you do more? But we've had 15 years of dismal, abysmal economic management in this country, and it's taking us orderly, thoughtful time to change the direction. That's what we're doing. We're being clear. Every Canadian knows what we're doing. We're being consistent, and we're being compassionate, and we're changing the system as Canadians have indicated that they want us to do. That's what they gave them us the mandate to do when they elected us in September of 84.
Go ahead, please.
Oh, Jack?
Yeah. Was that the wrong one? I took the wrong one. That's the right one. Go ahead, please.
Yes, good morning.
Morning.
Ms. Carney, I think most Canadians find it difficult to accept that taxes are the reason for our much higher gas prices. Isn't it a fact that the Americans are more prudent buyers on the world market than Canadians are?
I don't see how that would be the case. I mean, it's a world commodity market, and people buy oil from a whole lot of sources, and the Canadian price structure for crude oil is usually based on the price in West Texas. It's called West Texas Intermediate plus transportation costs. So I don't see how your submission could be true.
Well, only because the Americans are paying so much less for their gas. I realize that we're Canadians are taxed more, but...
You can do a little rule of thumb. When you buy a liter of gasoline, only one quarter of it is the price of crude. The rest of it is marketing, distribution, and taxes. The taxes take, in some provinces, close to 50% of the price of a gasoline.
And there's no way of escaping that now because we've got to pay for the social safety net.
Well, we have to pay for the services that we want. There is no free lunch.
Go ahead, please.
Hello, Ms. Carney?
Yes.
Yes. My question concerned Mr. Wilson and his budget. He's basing the part of arriving at the deficit figure of $29.8 billion is based on the fact that he's projecting oil prices to average out at nearly $24 U.S. this year. Now, the present price is around $13.14, and you indicated earlier in the show that it might even go lower. So in order for that average figure to be arrived at, it means the price is going to have to go back up to at least $30 at some point during the year. My question is, I was wondering, what do you think is going to cause the price of oil to double at some point during the year?
Well, it doesn't have to double. First of all, the oil market is extremely unstable. We do not know what is happening in it because there is a price war going on. Just like a price war at the gasoline pipe, there is a price war going on between the Saudis and the North Sea producers. We don't know how long it'll last, and we don't know what the overall implications will be. But I mean, at some point in time, it will stabilize. And the prices we see quoted in the paper are for spot oil shipments. The Brent price of oil in the North Sea. You don't know how the volume is that's being sold at that price. It's just an indicator. What we look at is the price at which oil is actually trading. Like when people are buying they buy under contracts and they buy spot. What is the overall price that oil is trading? And it's above what you see in the paper. So we don't really know what's going to happen to the price of oil. And the officials in finance really picked a number that they thought would be reasonably sure of emerging after the price war.
Yeah, but you're stuck with two things. Interest rates going down to 9.6 and an averaging upward of the price of oil at the trading level. And if you don't make these two things, your budgetary deficit could be over $30 billion.
Well, we have been pretty good about forecasting. Mike Wilson has been the first finance minister who actually brought in a budget at the numbers he said he would.
Fair enough.
Remember Mr. Lalonde and Mr. Kutchin and the others, they would announce they were going to do a budget of $10 billion deficit. It was 17. Mm-hmm. Mike Wilson said it was going to be, you know, around $34 billion, and he brought it in at $34 billion. So I'd rather trust his numbers than other people.
Well, let's have some short, sharp questions to Pat Carney now after the break. No more questions about gas prices, please. Let's get to the budget and see if we can get something interesting. Not that gas prices aren't interesting, but you go round and round in circles. Go ahead, please.
I have a budget question for Ms. Carney.
Right.
Our provincial treasurer has said that the federal transfer payments to British Columbia under the established program's financing have been reduced by $36 million. I'd like to know how much of this is a withholding penalty because British Columbia still permits user fees in hospitals which are not permitted under the Canada Health Act.
I don't believe any of it is because of user fees. And I want to point out, as we have over and over again, that we did not cut transfers to the provinces. We did not cut the amount of money going to the provinces. We cut the increase in the amount going to the provinces. I mean, if we have to have restraint across the board, you cannot just continue transferring money to the provinces at these very high rates. So Mike Wilson negotiated with the provinces. They're going to get more money, but not as much as they had originally expected.
Go ahead, please.
We've heard of cutting government spending. We hear that it's to pay for medical services. And Pat Carney said the reason for the high gas prices versus the U.S. was for our medical services. I would like to know why we're inundated with those stupid ads from the Department of Health and Welfare depicting that ridiculous old bald-headed man leaping around touting good health habits in a falsetto voice. The ads are insulting, they're sick, and they're an overhang for Monique Began. Why is the government wasting thousands, millions, no doubt, of dollars on those ads which are absolutely...
Listen, let me ask you a question. Is that the old man splitting wood?
No, it isn't. It's the old man leaping around, talking about his muscles are talking to him, and he's jumping out of a box in another ad. They're on your program, Jack.
Yeah, I know
the one. Is it a picture?
Hey, there's dozens of them.
Is it a picture of Jack Webster?
No, it is not. At least he's got hair.
I mean,
and the other question I'd like to ask before you cut me off is 2 weeks ago on CBC Radio, they were comparing gas prices, and they said the gas price in Ontario was 42 cents a liter. Here in Vernon, at that same day, the gas prices were 57 cents a liter. Why, when gas is weird?
Okay, I've got a question. Is it right about 42 cents a liter in, at the lowest in Ontario? Do you know?
I have no idea, because Ontario is going through a price war in parts of it. Governments don't set the price of gasoline.
Go ahead, please.
Gasoline is set in the marketplace and competition between gas stations. And if there's a price war going on in Toronto, there's going to be lower prices for gasoline than in Vernon.
Go ahead, please.
Jack, ask her, why is it that the old age pensioners have to pay so much income tax on their income?
Well, it depends what your income is, for goodness sake.
Well, I mean, the low income tax, like my mother used to have to pay income tax on her income from old age pension. And why is it that...
They pay the same rate as anyone else, plus a $2,950 extra exemption, and it depends on their income. Go ahead, please.
Yes, Mrs. Carney, the last time you were on Jack's show, you spoke of a large amount of money for retraining people. I've been about a year and a half trying to get retraining. I'm on a Canada pension, disability pension, and gain. All I need is about five night courses at VCIT. UIC tells me that in order to get training, I have to take a complete course. And this would be, you know, two-thirds of it would be redundant. I've worked most of my life in landscaping, and what I'm trying to do now,
And you can't get a grant for it.
I can't get anything for it, not even from...
From manpower.
Well, I think... Okay, well, possibly this, the new program announced in the budget... for older workers who've been unemployed would be the program that you could apply for. But who is your MP?
Mark Rose, I believe.
Well, get after Mark Rose, eh?
Well, yes. Well, it wouldn't be Mark Rose.
He's provincial.
No, I'm in. Coquitlam.
Probably Jerry St. Germain.
Bart Moody.
Okay,
Jerry St. Germain. That's right.
Phone Jerry's office, because. Under Flora McDonald's new program, we have local advisory councils which are set up to help pinpoint where the training needs should be. And if you call Jerry's office, it'll be in the book. They may be able to help you.
Go ahead, please. Hello.
Good morning, Jack.
Morning.
Good morning, Pat. How are you today?
I'm fine.
Good. Go ahead.
She's got the roles reversed, hasn't she?
Maybe she's applying for your job, Jack.
Go ahead. She can have it today. Go ahead, please.
Hello?
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm interested in this business of dropping 15,000 public servants over the next 5 years. I'm interested in this particularly because you've got over 250,000 there now, and this only represents a drop of 6%. And if you reconcile this with what's had to happen in industry where productivity has increased from 25 to 40%, it seems to me that you can do much better in the public service. Further, you have an annual attrition rate of 13,000, and I can't for the life of me understand why you feel it necessary to fire anybody or to give anybody an early pension. Because if you're only going to get rid of 5,000 this year, surely you're going to hire 8,000, and you can reconcile this without giving anybody the trauma of termination or paying anybody off.
This program, which is being administered by the president of the Treasury Board, Robert DeCoche, was negotiated with the civil servants. And it will mean that there are 15,000 less places in the civil service. So, some of the jobs which are lost through attrition have to be filled because they're jobs in those services where Canadians want the service. It's not simply a matter of dropping civil servants. There are all sorts of services provided by the government
of Canada.
But the
point he's making is that he says 13,000 attrition a year out of 250,000, and he believes you should get rid of a lot more than 15,000, don't you, Carla?
I believe, as a matter of fact, my background might be interesting so I can be understood. I worked in the mining industry for 35 years where we had to be efficient. Then I worked 10 years in the public service where I was shocked with what I saw.
Yep.
And the department where I worked, I'm satisfied the productivity could be increased 100%.
Yeah.
There were two fringe departments that could have been wiped out altogether.
Well, that's where we're moving, and we're moving in that direction. For instance, the operating budgets of departments have been cut in the past, and they're cut a further 2%. This year, our working reserves, the fund of money available for extra projects that come on have been severely cut. The civil service is being asked and encouraged and is cooperating in being more efficient, being more productive, and in doing more with less money.
Thank you. After the break. Oh, just by the way, to Pat Carney, do you think that the disappearance of Chrétien will destroy Turner's ability to lead the Liberal Party in Canada as of this day?
I don't get involved in that kind of partisan politics, as you know. I was sorry to see Jean Chrétien leave the House of Commons. He was there on Budget Day, sitting across from us, and I always think it's sad to see a parliamentarian who's given his life to the House of Commons leave under those circumstances. But I do think that Jean Chrétien will always be remembered for the work he did on the repatriation of the Constitution. And that's what he'll go down in history for.
Go ahead, please.
Not for energy minister.
Right.
Pat, it's Earl Hansen of the BC Motels Association.
Right.
And with the greatest of respect, I do have to differ very strongly with your comment that the gasoline price does not have a substantial effect in tourism. In fact, last year, the tourism deficit for Canada actually increased to $2.14 billion. And according to a paper that I recently saw from the Federal Ministry of Tourism, for every 1 cent increase in the price of gasoline, there's a 0.5% loss in American tourism to Canada. It is an issue that our industry feels very strongly about. And most tourists, when they come to Canada, come by car. And as a result of the non-competitive price, it has contributed to a very substantial deficit in our industry.
All right, can Pat help? You can't help at all.
Well, I can just say that the studies that we have completed, that Jack Murdo, the minister, has completed on this, show that there are a whole lot of factors affecting the decision by tourists to come to Canada, and that the price of gasoline is not a significant one. That's what a $1 million study we just did. And the tourist department is structuring the kind of advertising program, promotion program that will help the tourist industry here in BC.
So there you are, Adel.
Well, we'd like to meet with you, Pat, to discuss some of our information, because we do think that
I can meet with you, but if you're going to ask me or the Government of Canada to reduce taxes on gasoline, then you're going to have to show what programs that Canadians now get will have to be cut. I mean, there is no alternative. If you want reduced gasoline taxes, then you have to show us what services Canadians will have cut.
If we can reduce the deficit in tourism, which is over $2 billion, and keep some of those Canadian dollars at home, the job creation in our motels, our restaurants, our hotels, our gift shops, and various other aspects of tourism would take people off of UIC and create some jobs we very much need.
Well, if you have good ideas, bring them forward.
Thank you. Go ahead, please.
Jack, you were earlier threatened with a libel suit. I have two questions. Is the Conservative government adopting the so-called tactic of threatening libel to stop inquiry?
Only jocularly.
Secondly, in terms of the budget, given that the MPs have taken a pay cut, is there a provision in the budget for senators to take a cut in pay?
Hey, good question.
Yes, and one I do not know the answer to, because I just read in the paper this morning that the Senate budget is not being cut, and I can't tell you why that is. I do know that all senior management in the Government of Canada, that's your deputies,
right,
your assistant deputy ministers, get no pay increase. And I thought at the time, there must be a reason why the Senate...
No, there was nothing in the budget speech about it. Thanks for drawing our attention to it. Go ahead from Trail, please.
Yes, good morning, Jack.
Morning.
I'd like to thank you for bringing up this Cominco water tax issue. I'd also like to, if Mr. Bennett's watching, I'd like to let him know how Trail and Castlegar and the surrounding areas also feel about... knowing that this is an NDP riding, but he's not taking the right approach on trying to change things to his side.
Fair enough. Well, Pat's got a $69 million there, and they're just waiting for the $20 million, I think it is, or $12 million perhaps, to replace the water tax losses for Cominco to go ahead. You haven't had anything up there, though, have you?
No.
Oh, okay, boy, I'll let you know as soon as I hear. Go ahead from Quinnell.
Yes, firstly, I'd like to say that I think we weren't... The budget was very good, and I thought we were going to be hit a lot harder. But the question I'd like to ask is, why do I have to work 25 or 30 years to get a minimum pension, while an MP only has to work, 5 years to get a maximum pension?
No, it's not. We don't. The MP's pension is paid after 15 years of service, I believe it is, and you do not qualify, nor does the government pay into your pension fund for the first 6 years. So... in terms of why MPs get pensions, that has been resolved long before I got there. I can only say any MP who lasts for 15 years under this kind of schedule is probably so burned out that they're unemployable.
Go ahead, please.
Yeah, good morning, John. Mrs. McCartney, I sometimes watch you when you're sitting in the House of Parliament. You sit behind our fearless leader.
Yes.
And you look up at him as if to say, I can't believe that they're buying this. Now, Brian Mulroney reminds me of Pinocchio. Every time he makes a campaign promise, his chin gets bigger.
No, that's
can't just... believe that he's going on about jobs. Well, all those jobs seem to be created in Ontario. And apart from St. Patrick's Day, I really don't see him doing much else for the country. My term to resolve our problems here in British Columbia are perhaps to join as the 51st state of the United States, because we seem to be getting more from them because we spend all our July 1st holidays down in Blaine picking up a six-pack and buying buying gas there for cheaper prices.
Goodbye. Well,
let's see some car plants in British Columbia. Let's see British Columbia get something for a change instead of British Columbia having to give something to the East all the time.
Well, we're working on that. But first of all, let me say that I have nothing but the greatest admiration and respect for Prime Minister Brian Mulroney. It's an honor to sit behind him in the House because I get some very, very good lessons in how to answer questions from the Prime Minister. And I think that when you say he's done nothing for the country, he is the Prime Minister who has led this country into the first period of proper management and control over our spending since the Second World War.
Well, we'll leave you on that high plane and not even mention his magnificent techniques at obfuscation, which are unequaled by any other politician in the country.
Except by you, Jack.
No, I don't obfuscate.
Yes, if you don't, first of all, what does it mean?
Obfuscate means to confuse, to talk around the corner and a little bit of gobbledygook and double talk with a happy, charming smile on your face.
Jack, you have made a career out of doing that.
Thank you very much, Pat Carney. Okay. And when you get into the Oilman's Club in Calgary, make sure we can cover it.
Okay, and say hello to Mila Mulroney when she's your guest next week.
What the hell am I going to ask Mila Mulroney?
Ask her what it's like to be the wife of a prime minister who works 18 hours a day. I mean, ask them, when does he have any time for families? And how is Nicholas getting along?
Why don't she scrub any floors?
Oh, yes, she does. I happen to know that because...
I'll have to ask her about the Mounties saluting her, too,
no,
of course.
That's not true. Scrubbing
I'll
floors...
I'll have to ask her about it.
Okay, but she'll be a delightful guest. And you better treat her right, because she's a national asset.
Well, as an old chauvinist myself, I'm always polite to women. My thanks to Pat Carney, Minister of Energy. Now I've got my chance not to be so polite to women, because I have Samantha Sanderson from Media Watch, those people who think that ads do not portray men and girls properly in the media. You just blocked me right out of the camera.
Sorry.
That was sabotage, but thank you, Pat Carney.
Okay, thank you.
Back with Samantha after the break.
In effect, yes.
Samantha Sanderson is a lawyer in family law, but she's also a director of Media Watch, which is a national organization founded in 1981. And when they first came along, I, of course, in my usual male chauvinist way, snickered at what I regarded as their stupidities. Now I'm not quite so sure that they're all that daft. And that was the reason we showed that little Tourism Canada ad this morning, where you saw the nurses kicking up their heels in front of a hospital of some description. Well, they're going to show it again, are they? Yeah. Are they going to show it again? Roll it. Let's see it. Let's see it. Let's see it. Oh, it's coming any minute now. Maybe I could kick up my knees. In the meantime, I'm certainly not going to ask Samantha Sanderson to kick up her knees, I'll tell you that. Oh, yeah, this is the Tourism Canada commercial, very glitzy. And there, that's all there was. Short-skirted nurses. Was that offensive to you, ma'am?
It was.
Did you have it removed from the campaign, ma'am?
It looks like we have. We don't have an absolute certainty on that, but as I understand it, it's been withdrawn and they're going to work on that. However, they haven't yet given us any indication whether they're going to clean up the rest of it.
How do you do your monitoring of the media? Are you interested in print or print, radio, and television?
Yes, all three. We don't monitor. We're not a monitoring organization. We don't have that kind of resources.
Mm-hmm.
However, we did do a major monitoring study last year. We did a two-phase one to see whether or not there was any improvement. But in general, we don't monitor. It's only if the public comes to us, we hear a lot of complaint, or maybe we might pick something up ourselves and move on it. But essentially, we're not a monitor.
What are the areas of your concern? Because as you and I both know, sexual stereotyping has been used since time immemorial in the advertising business in North America and in Britain and in Europe. And it's not likely you're going to have sexual stereotyping removed from advertising, really, is it?
Yes, I think it is. I think, in fact, that if the advertisers want to sell their products, they're going to have to. And it's interesting, actually, there was a major national survey done by a market research organization last year. And that showed that, in fact, women are generally supportive of what are seen as women's issues, of women's role, the change in women's role.
What you're really trying to do is to eliminate the sexist aspect or the kind of soft porn aspects of advertising. Is that not really what you're after?
That's one of the things we're after. We're also after representing women in a more realistic way. That is who we really are. That is all ages, all sizes,
et cetera.
In other words,
what you want to see is you don't want to see glamorous 110-pound dollies on the screen. You want to see the average Canadian woman who is fat and thin, chunky, occasionally quite unattractive, normal, but you don't want to see her scrubbing floors.
Essentially, yes. And we also don't want to see any women being used as lures, to irrelevant to the product, simply.
They use as lures all the time. Look at the cosmetic ads.
Well, that's true, although in that area they're a little more related to the product that they're trying to sell. But when they're draped over cars, for instance, it's completely irrelevant.
Nothing to do with a car.
That's right. And so the question is, who are they selling? And we're against the selling, essentially, of women in the name of selling some other product.
What would you do? Would you like to have a bureau to censor all the ads and say, no, there aren't enough black people, old people, grannies? Do you want everybody on a quota basis in ads?
Well, nothing quite as definitive as that. Certainly, while it might be nice if we could pre-screen ads, that's a fairly dangerous concept, I have to agree.
Mm-hmm.
But we do think that a condition of license for broadcasters, for instance, should be some very specific steps in terms of increasing the participation of women. The statistics that are now available through the CRTC study show that the participation of women, as well as the portrayal, is simply outrageous, especially.
Do you mean the participation of women announcers, or do you mean the participation on the screen in dramas and series and whatnot?
Across the board.
So you want to see more women newscasters? You want to produce a woman Webster?
Absolutely.
I don't know that you could.
I think
now
we
that's
could.
A sexist, chauvinist remark.
I don't think there's any question that we could. It's maybe a slightly different style. Pat Carney was a good.
You're already suggesting someone take over my job. I have to quit and give it to Carney so that she gets equal time with me. No, I'm quite serious about that. Has there not been a vast influx of women into the announcing and the reporting business in the past 10 years?
Not really, no. In fact, the statistics are something along the lines of overall 29% of in public and news and public affairs, for instance, are female, but announcers are very few. Perhaps we may have said we've gone from nothing to something.
But here's one thing here, which is a bit silly. In television news, this is from Media Watch, women are most often, in television news, 89% of the experts interviewed are men. Well, that's the shape of society.
No.
Yes.
No, I don't agree. That's the shape
of the bias.
This morning,
100% of my guests were women.
Right.
This morning.
Right. There's
Carney
two experts.
And Sanderson.
That's right. And that's a good example of two experts. The problem is not so
well,
much.
Well, I use them whenever I can find them, but it's very difficult to find them sometimes.
That's the argument, but I don't think that's the reality. I think the reality is it's a mindset. And that when.
No, it's not a mindset. I'm going to fight with you on that. It's a question of what's available in the field of expertise on any given day and any given doings. If I were going to do a program on the economy tomorrow, right? Diana Cohen's in Toronto. Let me think of a woman economist. Damn difficult, but I can name you half a dozen economists whom I could phone up and say, hey, will you do a little shop with me tomorrow on the effect of the budget?
Mm-hmm.
It's not my fault. That's my only source.
I think it may be, to some extent, your fault.
But am I going to look for, say, well, I can't have this good man tomorrow. I've got to go and find a woman because my balance is out of kilter.
Yeah,
yes. No, I won't do that.
Yes. Well, the fact that you're not prepared to do it is the point.
I'm prepared to do it if they're visible.
Uh-huh. The point is, they just don't happen to be in your circle of friends. They're there. But the problem is they're not seen, they're not known, the network isn't working for them. So sure, you don't know their names. So that means a little affirmative action. There's no question. You may have to ask your researchers to go out and get you a list. And you may have to go out and make friends with them and see whether they're any good. But that's what I mean by a mindset. It's not necessarily because they're not there. It's because you don't know them.
No, they've got to come to the top first before we can get
they're,
at them.
They're at the top. They're just not known.
Good point, Samantha. Sexual stereotyping. What do you think of this Media Watch? Can I tell the little story I told you in makeup?
Yes, you can.
couple of years ago, 5 or 6 years ago on this program, I was taking a rather dull telephone call from a man, and there was a dog barking in the background, and I said with my usual light-hearted, nonchalant attitude, "Would you tell your wife to shut up?" I promptly got a very serious complaint from your people, for which I'm sure I apologized all over the lot, but it's still a very funny story. Your call to Samantha Sanderson. You see these men giggling? They have no sense of sensitivity. After the break.
Series on the movie industry. What's the matter? Good morning. Let me tell you about a couple of things that we're working on for today's new news hour. Another alcoholic beverage has been pulled off the shelves in BC. Four types of sherry are gone. The reason? They contain a chemical called ethyl carbonate, which has been found to cause cancer. Also, the last of our series on the movie industry in BC. Today, special effects. Where do they get those massive cobwebs they find in the movies anyway? Find out today on the new news hour.
7, 6, and 5. Samantha Sanderson, the media watch on sexual stereotyping in the public press and prints. Where am I going? Go ahead to Samantha.
Good morning. I would like to, I really am behind you all the way on this media watch. Some of the commercials that are out these days are a little strange. But you're watching for women's stereotyping. Lately, I've noticed that men's commercials, or if men are involved in them, they're coming off as looking like a bunch of stupid fools.
Sure are. They're all half naked. They're all slightly delicate.
Yes.
Annoys the hell out of me. Annoys me very
much. I know there are some men out there that are not all twits.
One or two of them. Now, what do you say to that?
I agree. I think that the stereotyping of men is as serious in many ways as the stereotyping of women. I think particularly in the areas of violence and how they deal with each other. The model that the media presents of men is that the only way, for instance, they can solve conflict is by shooting each other. That's a disastrous stereotype of men. So I agree, that isn't our focus, but we're certainly aware of it, and I think that men might take a look at it.
On the other hand, it should surely be left to the discretion of the viewer as to whether or not they're going to be influenced. I mean, if I see a commercial that offends me, I stay away from the product.
Mm-hmm. I don't think that's really realistic, though, when you consider that, in fact, this is a pretty well across the board, this kind of stereotyping. It's institutionalizing the values that we accept.
Yeah, I know, but you want to stereotype in your own way.
No.
You want to get away from all sexual stereotypes.
We want a glimpse of reality.
Yeah, but, you know, we're selling fantasy sometimes, not reality.
Well, we're suggesting that we should be reflecting reality, and that the fantasies should at least be positive ones.
Go ahead, please.
Good morning. My question is similar to the first lady that called in. I'm noticing a lot more men in the commercials, and very good-looking men, both in, like, the Coke ads, the beer ads.
Mm-hmm.
And the second question that I have is, how can she stop fantasy? I think it's part of everybody's life, and to say, well, you shouldn't have any fantasies now. I think a lot of people do buy with some fantasy in mind.
Well, I certainly don't. I'm not against fantasy. What I think I said is that positive fantasy makes a lot more sense than negative fantasy, and fantasy that simply repeats tired old stereotypes isn't particularly useful or creative or interesting.
But I think people are still going to be more interested in looking at somebody who's attractive rather than somebody who isn't. And
true
that
enough.
Works for politics,
I mean,
or commercials.
If you saw me without my makeup in the morning, what I can want, not that I'm a sex symbol of any kind, I hasten to add, but reality would be pretty upchucking at times.
Well, I think that what you brought up is a perfect example in that you are attractive on television, but the general concept is that a woman of your
age.
would not necessarily be acceptable. So I think we have to be fairly analytical when we look at what we accept as attractive and the differences is what's attractive allowed amongst women. The statistics show that women are almost non-existent on television over the age of 36.
Is that so? That's the kind of
that's
kiss
right.
of death at 36.
That's right.
And then the United States, of course, they go for these happy newscasts with all the happy, charming, good-looking boys and girls.
That's right. But if you look at our newscasts, you'll see that the women are, quote, attractive usually in the age group. The men don't have to be. And so that's what we're trying to change.
Yeah, well, we've got a couple of really good reporter women on the air, a number of them, all of whom happened by coincidence to be attractive.
There's no coincidence.
You mean they're picked because they're attractive as well as smart?
That's right.
Is that not an asset, therefore?
Well, it means that women have to be both attractive and smart, whereas men only have to be smart. Let's assume they have to be smart.
Oh, no, it's weird.
Perhaps we shouldn't get into that.
Back off. Go ahead, please.
Oh, Jack, yes. I was just thinking, there's one woman listening to you. If you had nothing but women on that program of yours, I don't think you'd be on the air very long. And that's not kidding.
The most important segment of an audience from a commercial point of view are the women, between about 20 and about 50, because they're the ones who influence the buying power.
You've got to have the man on to do the arguments and so on and so forth, because women cannot do it.
Oh, I wouldn't say that.
Oh, you know it. They can't.
Okay, bye. Well, I'm not going to argue with him. His mind's been made up for 80 years. Go ahead, please.
Good morning, Jack.
Good morning.
I'm a nurse, and I just wanted to say I'm not offended by that ad, but I am offended by the women's products on television, namely douches and sanitary products.
Mm-hmm. Do you have an attitude on that, Samantha?
I have my own view on that. That's a very different issue. I think what women react to there is embarrassment. It's just that whole aspect of women's lives has been so denigrated and kept so secret for so many centuries that now that it's shown, it embarrasses women. But the reality is, the more it's presented, advertised, for instance, the better the products will be. So I think in many ways, it's not against our interests.
It balances out, you say. Thank you, ma'am. Go ahead, please.
Morning, Jack. Are you familiar with those calendars with the scantily clad girls in bikinis, like Rigid Tools, Ripto, etc.?
No.
No. Well, every year they come up with these really interesting looking calendars with girls in bikinis.
Oh, you're talking about the Christmas calendars, the old kind of Christmas soft porno.
Yeah, more or less. They come around, they sell the power saws, etc., etc. They dropped off when you buy them, Ripto and all these other companies.
Yeah, that's been a custom. I don't know if it still goes on. Does that kind of thing offend you, ma'am?
Certainly, it's certainly not good for women, it's not good for men, and that is going into the area of violence against women.
It is. Go ahead, please. Well, just a minute, hold on. You're making signs at me. I'll be back after the break. One basic question I should have asked Samantha Sanderson of Media Watch is, what is the CRTC doing or has done about it?
They had a task force that met for 2 years, and out of that came the decision that the broadcasting industry and advertising industries would regulate themselves over a 2-year period and see if they could improve the portrayal of women. And in April, they're holding public hearings to decide on whether or not that was achieved. The statistics shown in the report they brought out would indicate that that hasn't been the case. There are going to be hearings in Vancouver where the public can have input, April 6th, and also in Hull, April 20th, and Montreal, April 27th. So it's an opportunity for the public to let the CRTC know whether or not the situation has improved, and if not, what they should do about it.
Good. April 6th, and you'll put out more information about the hearings, and so will the CRTC. Now, I just got to attend to a little matter here, Samantha, and I hope you'll accept my apologies, but it's the kind of thing. I'm talking to a man who's telling me that he's in the security wing in Oakalla, right? Are you there?
I'm here.
You don't want to give your name on the air, but you're in the security wing. Which unit are you in?
I'm in the South Wing Observation Unit on the roof of Oakalla.
All right, what are you doing in there? I mean, how long are you in for?
Serving a sentence of 29 months for dangerous driving offense.
Now, you say there are 4 or 5 inmates there who decided to phone Webster to get their grievances on the air.
Yes, that's right.
Just tell me simply your grievances. Don't forget, I haven't checked you out, but I think you're a legitimate call.
I am, believe me.
All right, tell me what your grievances are. Are they yours alone, or are these the grievances of the five?
Most of them are mine personally, but there's quite a few other inmates here that...
All right, what are your grievances?
I was assaulted by two senior staff, and upon entry of this institution in October, I've been threatened by guards with the use of fire hoses. I was transferred from maximum security unit to, from a minimum security unit to a maximum security unit with no reasons given. We found glass in the food. We can't eat the food anymore. I was placed on 23-hour lockup since December the 6th until now. At 72 days, we have charter of rights been denied 5 counts and been denied my family visits. We're missing mail, denied lawyer calls. We're missing money out of our accounts. I've had a couple guards phoning my common law wife's employment, and we're getting fed up with this.
Now, just a minute. I don't know if what you're telling me is true. Do you have a much of a record, or are you a first offender?
I'm more or less a first offender.
You've got no serious record behind you?
No. I've never been charged in the institution with any infractions of this institution whatsoever.
When do you go back into lockup?
In about 5 minutes.
You're in the yard right now, are you?
I'm in, yes, I am.
And you're the leader of 5 of them?
That's right.
You're not going to cause any trouble. You just wanted to air your complaints, some of which may be true and some of which may not be true, right?
It's all true, Mr. Webster. I'm getting fed up with this.
Well, I tell you what, we'll phone the authorities at Oakalla and see what... Have you tried to get in touch with the ombudsman?
Well, apparently there is no ombudsman.
Yes, there is.
Well, we haven't done that yet.
Okay, well, keep it cool and I'll pass your complaints on and see what kind of... response I get from the Department of Corrections. How's that?
Thank you, Mr. Webster.
Give me a call again next time you get a phone.
Okay, thank you.
Right.
Bye-bye.
Right. Forgive me for that. Yeah. It's the kind of thing you've got to do just in case.
Sure.
Go ahead, please, on Media Watch.
Is that me?
Yes.
You know, the cavorting nurses is just part of the unacceptable part of this whole film. I mean, it looks like a crazy, frenetic ad for Coke. I mean, we've got a beautiful country, and visitors to our country are not interested in nurses. They're interested in the geography, the scenery. Why didn't they concentrate on Canada?
Well, I'll tell you why they didn't. Because they felt that the good old green and pleasant land of Canada with mounties and mountaintops was not doing the job. And they wanted to depict this as a swinging place to which swinging, hyperactive Americans could come and not be stuck in the bush somewhere north of Muskoka.
I think it shows a colossal lack of imagination, and it, as a Canadian, I am mortified by the whole film.
Samantha?
Well, in many ways, I have to agree with the caller. I think much of it is completely irrelevant, and where we come in is the irrelevance of, for instance, a number of women in black bathing suits with black balls. What possible relevance has that to Canada? It's our concern around that whole commercial is the underlying message of essentially selling Canadian women.
It's a sensuous, sexy message.
It's essentially a girl next door method.
Stupid, is it? I am embarrassed. I didn't even watch the whole thing.
Okay, ma'am.
Who did this? This certainly doesn't represent my view of Canada. This is not what I want to present to visitors to
our
country.
Good girl. Thank you. Go to another call. Go ahead, please.
Yes, Samantha?
Yes.
Yes.
I find you very insensitive and also chauvinistic to the part that a woman just phoned in on hygiene, and here I am, a man waiting on the line, too. It bothers me very much when I sit down and I decide to have supper watching TV, and I have to watch a hygiene commercial about the smell and the odor-free and the everything else. And then the intelligence of women, you watch a woman slide down a mud hill, and it's more important that she check whether her hygiene pad is in her pocket or whether she's been hurt or not.
I have to agree with you. The ads are absolutely appalling. But the reality is everything else is advertised. Let's face it, we hear about our... deodorant, et cetera, et cetera. And so I think the ads themselves are absolutely appalling, but the product is really fair game along with all the others.
Go ahead, please.
Yes, good morning. In support of Samantha Sanderson's position that there are many female experts in many fields of endeavor, I think it's a real sad fact that you, Mr. Webster, are so visibly sexist in that you won't make the effort to seek female experts unless they're famous and highly visible. Number two, I find your supposed attempt of humor at the expense of women regarding your barking dog story is extremely in bad taste, in very poor taste, and I'm surprised that you would even say it a second time. Thank you.
Sorry, ma'am.
Yeah, I have to apologize, too, in that I probably should have said, don't tell it.
Oh, yeah, but I can't take refuge in the fact that I asked your permission. No, no, no. I shouldn't have told it again. I am a little insensitive at times, but I make no apologies on the availability of women experts. Men experts make themselves known through the more established system. It's up to women to make themselves known, too.
Well, now, my response to that has a lot to do with what I'm talking about here.
Oh,
is
yeah.
the whole system, for instance, of the media is representing only 48% of the population. So that really what we've got here is freedom of expression, freedom of role modeling, freedom of networking for 48% of the population. So that to say that women have got to do it, you're not giving them the airtime to do it.
Good point, I must tell you. My thanks to Samantha Sanderson, the Media Watch, CRTC hearings in April. And we'll let you know about them when they come up. Thank you very much, Samantha. And I shall be back to close off the program after the break. On Monday's program, we will have the recommendations, hopefully, of the Wilderness Committee dealing with Lyle Island and the Moresbys. Going to have Bob Williams, the NDP industry critic, on the air, and I'm going to have Alma McGauley, who is going to say her piece about the trouble of the Teachers Investment and Housing Cooperative. That's all on Monday morning. Williams should be good. I haven't had him on the air for years. One of the powers of the NDP. Who knows, there might be an election yet. And I'll be back with Webster at all Monday at 9 a.m. precisely.
And as for my personal views, I still would not like to make them known, although my family are supporters of Mrs. Aquino.
I think that we've gone about as far as we can go in raising taxes. I think many Canadians are beginning to agree with that. And so I think that we really ought to be cutting expenditures.
There is no gore on the floor in the budget brought down by Michael Wilson. Jean Chrétien, number two to John Turner, today turned in his seat in the House of Commons.
Is it not a more beautiful day to make a big move? Sunshine and snow in February, it's perfect.
Expo 86, 63 days to go.